Should wearing a mask be like wearing a seatbelt? That's the top question of the day. It's a question that was posed by former FDA Commissioner Scott Gottlieb during an interview this weekend, talking about what we're seeing in America and an increase in infections of COVID-19. Hope you're off to a great start to your week. We have some breaking news. I'm at my desk, a little change of scenery from where I normally shoot Coffee Talk, because I'm looking at a new ruling by the Supreme Court, which we'll get to in just a moment. We're going to get a lot of rulings over the next several days as the Supreme Court sort of winds down this chapter of their cases that they're seeing. So let's talk a little bit about COVID-19 in America. Should wearing a mask be like wearing a seatbelt? Former Commissioner Scott Gottlieb said this in an interview that was actually slightly hopeful. He said, listen, we're in the middle of an outbreak right now, and we are going to have therapeutics, treatments for COVID-19 in 2021. Likely have a vaccine, but right now we don't have anything. So for that reason, just like you put a seatbelt on, you should wear a mask in America. Now, we're seeing increases in infections in more than half of US states. So we're not the only country in the world that is struggling with this question about mask wearing, but I want to give you a couple examples of places that have adopted mask wearing and the results that they've seen. Hong Kong is one of them. Hong Kong, about 97% of people during a morning commute wear a mask. In Hong Kong, they have millions of travelers come to one of the most densely populated places in the entire world every day. Majority, or at least half of those travelers, are actually coming from mainland China, where you know the COVID-19 outbreak first emerged. How many deaths do you think Hong Kong has from COVID-19? Six. That's one of the strongest arguments for mask wearing out in the world today. There's universal masking, meaning a high percentage of the population wear masks. All right, so you might say, well, let's not look at Asia, let's look somewhere else. We can look at the Czech Republic. The Czech Republic is a place that mandated mask wearing early on in the crisis. And there's other factors, but they are seeing about 50 cases of COVID-19 a day. The United States is seeing 40,000. So some of you have asked, well, what about the data for wearing masks? You know, what about negatives attached to that? It's a great question, and we know that there'll be new research coming as we're looking at this pandemic. The research right now suggests universal masking is a cheap and easy way to blunt the spread of the infection, but at least 80% of people have to wear it to make a dent in the curve. If you're alone wearing it, it's not that it doesn't matter. You know, I think that's a falsehood. You know, well, no one else is wearing, so I'm not gonna wear it. There is a benefit to you for wearing it. There's a benefit to others wearing it. In order for us to impact the pandemic overall, the majority of us have to be doing it. So watch for information on that this week. The reason why I mention it is because there have been those that have posed this argument to say, listen, this is a cheap and easy way for us not to shut down again. We're already seeing states like Texas try to shut down certain parts of the economy like bars because they're concerned about the spread of COVID-19, but they don't want to go into a complete and total shutdown. That's not good for the economy. And we're looking at really big states like California, Texas, and Florida. California is the fifth largest economy in the world, let alone its importance to the United States. So shutting it down again, if it came to that, which no one wants, would be a really big deal for the global economy. So this is why I want you to watch this topic. Watch to see what happens. We are seeing governors mandate it in different states. Let's just see what happens over the next week. Some of you asked the question, well, why is there such a difference in advice from local governments to federal officials on what's going on with COVID-19? I want you to keep this in mind. When there's a hurricane coming towards the city, who makes the calls about evacuations? Oftentimes it's the local officials or the governor even of a state. And local officials have a tough call because they can't make the call to evacuate too early, because if the storm turns and they did this mass disruption, they're going to be to blame and no one's going to listen to them next time. If they do it too late, then they could cause the unnecessary death of a lot of people. And so local officials are in this sort of question about how to advise their local population about COVID-19. We are not seeing hospitals tip over capacity yet in places like Houston, but there's a concern about that. And so that's the call that the local officials are trying to make. How do they alert the public but not cause panic? How do they make the right decision for not today, but what's 7-10 days from now? So this is why there's a difference. It would be great if everyone's uniform, But that's not the case right now. We are seeing different circumstances for infection around the country. So we'll keep you posted on that. One health story that's not going to get any attention that I really feel like I'm compelled to mention to you. The CDC has sent out several alerts about this. It's a cyclospora outbreak. Really in the Midwest of America, they're seeing about 200 cases of a parasite that they've tied back to a salad mix. And the reason why I mention this is one, I'm sorry to mention this so early, but we have to have an honest conversation. It causes a lot of stomach upset, lots of diarrhea. This is one of the symptoms that's also been associated with COVID-19. Since a lot of us are staying home and cooking, I just feel like you should know it's out there. You have to be tested specifically for this parasite to know if you have it. And I had this last year. I had this parasite last year and no one knew what was wrong with me. It took me about 2 months to get diagnosed. I was 9 months pregnant, and it was the sickest I've been in a really long time. So if it grows, if the outbreak grows, I'll do a whole 10 minutes for you on what I've learned about cyclospora. But I think the big takeaway from it is you should know that it's out there. You should know it's with lettuce mix in the Midwest specifically. There are some people hospitalized from it. And it can be treated really easily with antibiotics, but you should know that that it's out there. Supreme Court today, really important, big ruling on abortion. The reason why this ruling matters is not just because of the circumstances around the state of Louisiana. It matters because we have seen two appointees by President Trump on the Supreme Court. This is the first time that the court, with its new dynamic, is taking up an abortion ruling. So how would the court rule? This is why a lot of folks are watching this, because the judges that have been appointed have been considered quote-unquote conservative judges. So they're not supposed to be conservative, but this is how they're described. So the ruling today by the Supreme Court was on a Louisiana law that attempted to say that doctors in the state of Louisiana would need to be able to admit to a hospital 30 miles away from an abortion clinic. The argument for those that wanted to put the law in place is to say this would be for the safety of the person that's getting the procedure. Those that did not like the law said this is a way that you're already trying to limit abortion in the state of Louisiana, where it's very limited as far as resources. So the Supreme Court ruled today against the Louisiana law, said that it can't take place. Essentially, this is very similar to a law that came up in Texas several years ago, but again, notable because of the new makeup of the Supreme Court. The two appointees, Judge Gorsuch and Judge Kavanaugh, both ruled in favor of letting the law stand, but the majority of the court ruled against it, so it does not stand. We're going to have more on this case. It's an important case, and you're seeing a lot of challenges to abortion from different states, from different perspectives, and I think it's a good time to review, well, what is Roe v. Wade? What is the current law? Because I think there's some misconceptions about the current law, and what are the challenges? So we'll make sure to flag that for you, because this is not, these challenges are going to continue. Final quick thing. Mississippi has voted to remove its flag. It's the last state, or the only state, I should say, that had a Confederate symbol on its state flag. So voters are going to take up a new flag in November. But here's the little twist of the story that I think is really interesting. In addition to watching Democrats and Republicans really come together, very emotional about voting on a replacement for the flag. The new flag will have "In God We Trust." It's our understanding that's what the new flag will have. "In God We Trust" is on our money, right, in America. Did you know "In God We Trust" was started to be put on currency in America during the time of the Civil War? Because according to the Treasury Department, there was an increase of basically a faith during a time when there was great uncertainty about the future of the Union. So we can actually trace the "In God We Trust" that we have on our currency now to the 1860s, which is an interesting remnant of the Civil War that I never knew about, so I wanted to share that with you. All right, questions, comments, let me know. You can always comment on this video wherever it's posted, or you can email us at hello@smarternews.com. Whew, deep breath. That's a lot of news today, guys. I hope it made you smarter. I certainly enjoyed putting it together, and I look forward to seeing you every day. So thanks for your support on Smarter News, and have a great start to your week. Bye, guys.